Our discussion is on strain. Simple strain is also known as unit deformation. Strain is the ratio of the change in length caused by the applied force to the original length. So we have here an illustration. We have an applied force, and as you apply the force, there will be a deformation, there will be a change on the original length. So therefore, strain actually is equivalent to deformation all over L. So this is the formula to have the value for strain. So we have here a stress strain diagram. So for example, a metal specimen is being placed in a tension compression testing machine. So as we try to apply an axial load, which we increase gradually in increment, the total elongation over the gauge length is measured at each increment of the load, and this is continued until failure of the specimen takes place. So knowing the original cross-sectional area and the length of the specimen, the normal stress and the strain can be determined, or it can be obtained. So we have here the graph of the quantities with the stress along the y-axis. And we have our strain, which is along the x-axis. So this is what we call our stress-strain diagram. So basically, our stress-strain diagram differs in form for various material. So this diagram, for this stress-strain diagram, this is an illustration for a medium carbon structural steel. So for this one, a metallic engineering material are classified as either ductile or brittle material. So on our stress strain diagram, if we can observe, we have here stages before it goes through the actual rupture strength, or before it proceeds to the rupture strength. So first here on our graph, we have our peak, which is the proportional limit. So from the origin to the point called proportional limit, the stress strain curve is a straight line. So if you can observe, from the origin towards our proportional limit, our P, as illustrated, this is a straight line. This linear relation between elongation and the actual force causing was first noticed by Sir Robert Hooke in 1678, and is usually called as Hooke's law, that within the proportional limit, and the stress is directly proportional to strain. So basically, for that, we have here our relationship that our stress is directly proportional to strain, or we can have stress is equal to K times E. So the constant of proportionality K is called the modulus of elasticity, or Young's modulus, and that is equivalent to the stress strain diagram from O to P. So we can have our stress is equal to modulus of elasticity multiplied to our strain. Then we have what we call the elastic limit. So we have the next stage, which has the elastic limit, is the limit beyond which the material will no longer go back to its original shape when the load is removed, or it is the maximum stress that may be developed such that there is no permanent or residual deformation when the load is entirely removed. So for this one, for our elastic limit, so the material, once it reaches the elastic limit, it can no longer go back to original shape, even though the load will be removed. Then we have the next one, which is our yield point. The yield point is the point at which the material will have an appreciable elongation or yielding without any increase in load. So this one for the yield point, meaning to say it will continue to elongate or to yield even there is no increase in load being applied. Then we have our ultimate strength. The ultimate, we have the rupture strength. So the rupture strength is the strength of the material at rupture. This is also known as the breaking strength. So this is our breaking point. So as it reaches the breaking point, so this what we call now as rupture strength. Then we have the ultimate strength. The ultimate strength is the maximum ordinate in the stress strain diagram, which is the ultimate strength or tensile strength. So those are actually the stages of our stress strain diagram. Axial deformation. In the linear portion of the stress strain diagram, the stress is proportional to strain and is given by this equation that stress is proportional to strain. So since stress is equal to P all over A and strain is equal to delta all over L, so we can have the relationship that P all over A is equal to modulus of elasticity times delta all over L. So we simply have substituted the value for stress, which is equal to P all over A, and the value for our strain, which is delta all over L. So we simply have this relationship that P all over A is equal to modulus of elasticity times delta all over L. So if we try to solve for our deformation delta, that will be equivalent. You simply have to manipulate this equation. You simply have the value P all over BL all over AE. Since P over A is equal to stress, so we can have deformation is equal to stress times L all over A. So we can make use of this formula if the load is axial. The bar must have a uniform cross-sectional area. The stress must not exceed the proportional limit. If, however, the cross-sectional area is not uniform, the axial deformation can be determined by considering a differential length and apply integration. So we have to consider this illustration. Once the cross-sectional area is not uniform, we have to apply a differential. We have to consider differential length and apply integration. So this is an illustration. So therefore, based on the illustration, we try to consider a differential length. So therefore, our deformation is equal to P over E, the integral of 0 to L, dx all over A. So our A is equivalent to T times Y, or thickness times the height. And they must be expressed in terms of X. So for the rod of unit mass, rho, suspended vertically from one end, the total elongation due to its weight is equivalent to this equation, wherein rho is in kilogram per cubic meter, L is the length of the rod in millimeter, and M is the total mass of the rod in kilogram, A is the cross-sectional area of the rod in mm squared, and G is equal to 9.81 meter per second squared. The stiffness K is the ratio of the steady force acting on an elastic body to the resulting displacement. It has a unit of Newton per mm. So stiffness K is equal to P all over deformation, or that is force all over deformation. Problem 1. A steel rod having a cross-sectional area of 300 mm squared and a length of 115 matter is suspended vertically from one end. It supports a tensile load of 20 kN at the lower end. If the unit mass of steel is 7,850 kilogram per cubic meter, and E is modulus of elasticity is 200 times 10 cubic meter, meganewton per meter squared, find the total elongation of the rod. So we have here a steel rod. It has a mass of, unit mass of the steel is 7,850 kilogram per cubic meter. So what would be the total elongation? So for this one, we let So we let delta would be the total elongation. Then we have delta 1, elongation due to its own weight. We have delta 2, elongation due to applied load. Then, of course, for mathematically, it can be expressed as total elongation is equal to delta 1 plus delta 2. Let's try to compute first for delta 1. Of course, delta 1 is equal to EL all over AE. So we have to identify our P, which is due to its own weight. So therefore, our P here is equal to the weight of the steel, and that will be equivalent to, we're given with the unit mass of the steel, 7,850 kilogram per cubic meter. Try to convert this one into millimeter. So we try to multiply by 1 over 1,000 to the third. Then multiply to the gravitational force, which has 9.81. And so that we can get now the value for our unit weight of the steel. So this would be 7,850, convert to mm cube, so 1 over 1,000 raised to the third times 9.81. So this is now the unit weight of the steel, multiply to the volume, multiply to the area, or to the volume rather, we're given with the cross-sectional area, which is 3,000, and the length is 150. This is meter. We convert this one to mm, so multiply this by 1,000. So if we try to simplify this one, what remains? This is in cubic. This is now in cubic. This is mm cube. This is for the volume. Then this one, this portion we have here converted. This is, we try to have, we have converted our cubic meter into mm cube. So this now becomes kilogram per cubic, per mm cube. Then we have here mm cube. So we have here kilogram per mm cube. Then we have here mm cube. So we can cancel that one. So what remains is kilogram meter per second squared, because 9.81 is meter per second squared. So this gives us 3,465.3825 newton. So we have now our P. And for the length, that will be equivalent to we're given with the length, which is 75.